So I guess the experiences that you have some sort of initial reaction for you, and then if they, you know, have an impact, if they stick with you, then you start to think about them later on, and you know, you might make a change either consciously or subconsciously in the way that you act, and that can have a change on your life or an effect on your life.
Like say if I want to make a decision in life, like it might be simple as crossing the street, but since I've seen people like crash or something, I just don't want to like risk it unless they let me cross the street. So think twice, that's what I think.
Being here, my mind changes all the time, just like learning new things. Usually my opinions are wrong most of the time, I don't know, I learn new things. So whenever somebody tells me facts or gives me their opinion, it often changes my mind.
I mean, like, we're always growing up in knowledge and experience. So this is all a combination. You always get new information, either formal or informal, that is from school, from family, from friends. And that for sure makes you a different person on a daily basis.
I feel that it makes me more well-rounded and more accepting of things in general, whether it's new people or new ideas. I feel that definitely helps in that aspect.
I guess in a way it makes you more open-minded. Like, so you learn something you didn't know before?
I believe once you receive new information, you apply it to what you already know. And if it's better, then you'll change the way you look at things and the way you approach certain aspects in life.
I feel new experiences are definitely the core of what changes your mind. Like, if you are stuck in a certain place, I think of like small towns, and you're continuously around the same people who think the same thing, you're not going to ever experience anything beyond that. So, which I think being open to this new experience is going outside of that town, going, trying different things, that really expands our minds, yes.
For a long time, I've had as sort of the trailer at the end of my email messages, this Japanese saying, to teach is to learn. And I really feel like that's very accurate. By teaching others about how to do research, by teaching in class, everything that I do, I'm constantly learning new things. And it really changes my outlook, the way I teach in the future, the way I approach things.
One of the conceptions in the field is that you learn episodes, you learn things that are going on right now, so I will remember this interview. That would be a memory. And that is a memory, but I think what's forgotten in that approach, that logical approach, is that my memory of this event is going to be based in heavily on all the other events that I remember and some that aren't remembered consciously from my entire life history, which means that what I remember of our meeting, this interview, will be different than what you remember of this interview, even though we're both having roughly the same experience. But what we brought into the room is very different. So memories are always building on each other.
My whole process of, the process of science is all about changing our minds, actually. And in fact, there's a great quote, and I always forget who said it, but it's like a Bertrand Russell or some great philosopher or scientist said that that we do science in order to, of course, test hypotheses and to check phenomena, and that we should be disputing our own hypotheses. And if we're not lucky enough to do that, we hope our best friends do that for us. So the idea is that we collect data, we make observations that actually inform us about the physical world, and that I think changes our ideas about how we view the physical world. So we go in with an idea, we see the data, we see sort of our manipulation of the world and the consequences of that, and then sort of formulate new ideas. And I think it's the viewing and observing these you know, changes that actually can then change our own minds about phenomena.
I guess one thing that I could characterize as being somewhat surprising that has changed our mind in our research is the fact that some of the effects that we see of drug exposure during adolescence are very different in males and females. One of the things we've seen in our research is that in some instances, females are more sensitive to the effects of repeated drug exposure in adolescence. And in other sense, in other instances, they're less sensitive. We didn't know that we were going to get a sex difference like we got. And I think it's interesting to try to understand that sort of a phenomenon and understand what's causing it.
Ideally, we should be able to assemble the information and judge it on a rational basis. Apparently, what we do, if what I've read is correct, and this is from, you know, great medical journals like the New York Times, we often make up our minds, say, about somebody new that we meet within 30 seconds, which is hardly enough time for rational information. So, on the other hand, when we're talking about something that is subject to rational thought, or when we decide to think about it, then new information should affect us depending on the quality of the information and what we think of the source. And especially for me in toxicology, the source does matter. And I'm not saying that academic sources are always reliable and industrial sources aren't. Some of the best toxicologists I know of are in industry, actually. And I've known some academics who have very definite biases, and you have to take those into account in reading their work. So the source matters a lot. And then the quality of the information. Are the data there? Can we actually, you know, is there actually information there? Can we validate it from something else? Can we corroborate it from some other source? And, you know, as a scientist, that's the sort of, that's how I decide on the validity of a hypothesis, I hope. And I have to add that because there's always the risk that I'm fooling myself. Thank you.